everyone. Thank you so much for being here today. My name is Alana Harvey. I'm the e-mobility business innovation leader here at Schneider Electric, and I'm so excited to have some wonderful minds in the e-mobility industry to talk about EVs and homes of the future. So let's go around and have an introduction. I'm going to start.
Thank you, Alana. It's an honor to be here and excited to kind of share some of the stuff that we are experiencing with our company. My name is Suman Pushparajam, CEO of Steer EV. We're an EV car subscription company. We acquired this company from Exelon in 2019. So what we do is we provide EVs for homes where your car payment, insurance, maintenance, everything's included in a package. You have a flexibility of getting in and out of cars. You're able to swap between publicly listed company. We are looking to expand into the European market. We currently operate in US and Canada at this time. Love to kind of share what we're hearing from a consumer side and excited to be here.
Awesome. Yeah, thank you, Suman. Go ahead, Robert.
Yes, my name is Robert Lopez. I am with Graybar Renewables. I'm the national sales manager, and I've been in renewables since 2007.
Pleasure to see all you guys this afternoon. Bill Hotchkiss, the Director of Energy Assets within General Motors and the newly announced General Motors Energy Business Unit. I've been with General Motors for 20 years, primarily in the auto side of the business, but now as we make our foray into the energy sector, be leading the product division. So pleasure to be with you guys this afternoon.
Awesome. Thank you guys so much for introducing yourselves. Let's go ahead. We're going to get right into it. So I'm going to just ask you guys questions and we can kind of go down the line and have responses. So my first question for you guys here is, what are you most excited about in regards to the growth of new EV technology? Do you
want
to start?
Sure, I'll start first. So I think it's, one of the things that I'm excited about is a lot of people want to do great, to offset carbon, to want to do good things, but they don't know how. And I think EV allows them to, as an individual, to reduce their carbon footprint. That's something that I'm really excited about. Secondly, what we see with EVs is there's a lot of data that is available. So we capture for, our subscribers, we capture their trips, their charging habits. So it allows, smart cities and manufacturers to understand what consumers are looking for. So there's a lot of data that's available, and that's pretty exciting for me as well. And then lastly, I just want to add is that these, EVs are more like, you look at your typical, your phone versus smartphone, the cars allows you to help you reduce, human errors as well. So that's pretty exciting. It's, notification, you can't even switch lane, and it, it helps people. Those are some of the things that are really exciting. As well.
Yeah, definitely. The whole smart technology thing is where we're going towards in the world. Awesome. Go ahead, Robert.
Yeah, I think from a consumer standpoint, that what I'm really excited for is, how is this going to integrate into the retrofit world and into the smart world, the smart home world? So, for example, how is this going to give homeowners better control of their load control, their use, and ultimately their costs of energy? So we're really excited about seeing the more of the integration piece of all kind of IoT, EV, solar, all of that type of stuff.
Definitely. Go ahead, William.
Yeah, I'll give my two cents. So at General Motors, we believe in all electric future. So by 2035, we're going to be completely electrified. Someone who's been with the company for a long time, obviously the internal combustion engine has been our bread and butter, but we're going through a huge revolution because we understand the need of society. We understand the benefits of electric vehicles to help with some of those challenges in society. And as we think about the vehicle, we're going to be one of the largest battery cell manufacturers in the world with our partnerships with LG, building and producing over 90 gigawatt hours of battery capacity here stateside. That gives us a huge opportunity to not only disrupt the automobile sector, but as the EV becomes a battery on wheels, as you will, it's an asset that can integrate into the grid. It'd be quite powerful, and I think that's really what we're here to talk about today is the EV not as a mobility asset, but how it plays in the role of the grid of the future. So it's a huge opportunity, and we're so excited about what we can do at General Motors with it.
Yeah, definitely. Sure. And we know even in the other talks that we've had throughout the entire Innovation Summit, that's been a really big theme. Do you have something you wanted to add?
No, I said that's just really exciting to see GM Energy jump into this and kind of be a disruptor in the space. It's pretty exciting.
Yeah. All right, going to move on to the next question. So what do you see as the biggest challenge of new EV technology around the homes of the future?
I mean, a couple of things. First is that fear. So, you know, as a consumer, when they get into the vehicle, they always have to figure out, okay, do I have enough, you know, how much charge do I need to have? Is there the range? And if there's enough infrastructure, especially in, you know, countries like where it's cold, because the battery drops quite a bit as well overnight. So there's that fear still exists. And I think that's one of the challenges. And the second thing is the amount of time that's required to charge. And I know technology is improving, like, you know, where the GM and others are coming in. But in terms of producing mass, those are a couple of the challenges that we still need to get through to. That's what you're seeing from a consumer side.
Yeah, fear of the unknown.
Right.
Everyone's always scared of change eventually, but we're going to do it. We're going to do great.
I think the challenges are, you know, there's a few. Obviously, I have a Tesla. I've had it for 2 years, and I've had solar for 8 years. So I've kind of lived in this environment. And, you know, one of the challenges that, you know, I was excited about listening in on some of these forums was, you know, when you add another car or you have a third car, you know, what does that do to your MPU and to your load, and how long does it take you to charge these vehicles? I think those are some of the concerns that I still have. And with batteries still being quite expensive, although I did hear 108 new vehicles are coming on board, which is going to, you know, all that battery technology is going to lower the cost of batteries, hopefully. So ultimately, I think, you know, this is kind of where I think we're in the early days of like solar was in 2007, 2008, where it's going to be a bumpy road to get to where we ultimately want to be. But I think obviously with companies like GM jumping in this, you know, this is where this is headed.
Yeah. And we have to start somewhere, too.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well,
the good news is we can help you with that Tesla problem you have. We have 20 new electric vehicles coming out over the next 3 years, and really product offerings from compact all the way up through luxury. So don't worry. Anybody who wants a General Motors vehicle in the room, I guarantee you we can help you with that. But I think you hit on it, is it's the fear of the unknown. The exciting part about this is we've been working on EVs for decades now with them, General Motors, not, you know, going back to the early, you know, charter of the company, to be honest. There's huge benefits of electric vehicles. There's performance benefits for those that are in performance enthusiasts. There's this opportunity to tie it back into the grid, provide benefits from, you know, resiliency, cost making, money making, money saving, and then obviously the benefits to society and what we're trying to do to lower emissions. So I think the more we can educate folks, we've set up an education center called EV Live, where we're actually walking customers through some of these unknowns to help bring comfort and familiarity to this new sector. So yeah, I mean, it's going to come with some growing pains, but I think once customers start to see the benefit of it, you know, they'll appreciate the disruption that comes with it. I mean, you'll think, what, 12 years ago, smartphones were an unknown, and now they're commonplace with everybody in this room. So I think electrification is very much going to be synonymous in 10 years. We'll be looking back and say, why don't we do it earlier?
Yeah, definitely. And I'm glad that you brought up benefits, because that's what we're going to talk about next. Mm-hmm. So let's say I'm a homeowner and I live in an area where there's maybe kind of like this extreme weather events, you know, Florida with the flooding, and I lose power a lot. Most homeowners, their first thought would be, I'm going to run to the store and get a gas power generator. That's what they think the easiest option is. So can you all tell me what some of the benefits of purchasing an EV instead would be? You want to go first,
Sure, I can. I mean, I think from my side, what I've seen is we run a pilot in Toronto where we used EV as storage and then send it back using Nissan Leafs as well. We've seen a lot of success with it. So I think, you know, where they could be using EV as generators, I think it's an easy adoption as we move forward. As a consumer, they will feel comfortable doing it.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I think it's... It's kind of weird for me, because I just moved from California to North Carolina, and we've had some weather events where I've seen my neighbors roll out the generators. So, you know, it could be down from an hour to a couple days. And the funniest part about it is that I've caught my 13-year-old in my Tesla charging her car during these outages. So obviously the, you know, bi-directional use of backfeeding your home with your car is very exciting. But I still think in certain areas, like I have people here from Canada, they know this, you know, they can go out without power for a few days. So, you know, I think a generator still has a place in the space. Obviously, what we're talking about, batteries and solar, isn't going to be the total answer. I mean, the answer is going to be a bunch of a lot of different things, actually. That's what I think on that.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, the reality is we have a lot of challenges with the grid in our country today. I mean, for us to be having the amount of blackouts we had to have as a developed country, I think we have the most blackouts of any developed country in the world, which is extraordinary. And those who live in California know what it's like to live with, you know, these planned service shutouts. Customers want optionality. What the vehicle brings is, you know, the functionality as a mobility solution, but now this, you know, our Silverado, which we're launching with the bidirectional charger we announced yesterday, has a 200 kilowatt hour battery. I mean, that's days of backup, energy. That's something that, you know, a Powerwall just doesn't offer today. A Powerwall is 13 kilowatt hours. And most customers don't need to use that mobility functionality as much as the battery capacity allows. It provides range. We need to go from Detroit to Chicago, but it doesn't necessarily need for your daily commute. So that's unused, I'll call it functionality, that when connected into the grid through the home provides a huge opportunity. And I think that's a very similar vision to what Schneider has with their prosumer offerings. I think that is the future. You know, having a stationary storage box coupled with a vehicle or two in the home, a solar generating renewable on your roof, the balance between those assets, once it gets down to a price that can be adopted at a mass consumption, I think it's a huge opportunity for us. And that's why General Motors has announced to enter into the energy space. We think we can provide that wholesome ecosystem that no one's offering today. And with partners like companies at Schneider and what we announced at SunPower, it's the way of the future, distributed energy and generation.
Thank you for that, William. Yeah. We did use a few words that I'm not sure the audience may know. So just
it's education time.
Yeah, just to go over it a little bit. Use the words bidirectional. So when we talk about bidirectional, we mean the vehicle being able to power the house in the event of a blackout. And then also the word prosumer, which is homeowners who are producing the energy that they consume, and like kind of back and forth as well with that. So to talk a little bit more about prosumer. So the industry for homeowners to be prosumers is advancing rapidly. What are some of the challenges do you think for utility companies with the growth of a prosumer market? Either any of you can respond.
I'll take a first crack at it. Well, utilities 100% will be partners in this. We understand that this space is still evolving. Utilities have done an amazing job to provide stable energy for decades here, but there is going to be a fundamental shift in the way that power is generated or created and distributed. And working with utilities as partners, we can bring solutions together that can bring stability, and that's the end goal game here. So as cost of energy rises from some of these traditional sources, as non-traditional renewables become cheaper, I think this is an opportunity to work with utilities to solve a very important societal problem for us.
Yeah, I mean, I pretty much agree with what Bill just said here. I mean, it's utilities have to be part of the solution here. And I think that the utilities, at least the ones I've been used to, are a little bit behind bringing solutions to this. I think they were in the driver's seat for a long time. And, in our business, we run commercial and utility too, and it's even more difficult in those areas. So they do have to come to the table. And I think that this move to digitization is really moving them to come to the table and work with companies like Schneider and others to figure out how we're going to get this to the prosumer.
I mean, this space is literally at the inception. We're at the, I'll call it, inflection point of, you know, disrupting a 100-year business industry. The way that, you know, again, like I mentioned before, power is generated, the way it's distributed, energy is distributed, is going to change. And we all play a role in this because it's such an important role in, changing this societal challenge. So, you know, there's so many different business models, whether it's using cars as a rental options or subscription models. Those are plugged in the grid at a fleet hub. And this is the change that we're looking for and we're hoping to drive with all of you.
And we have to work together to
Absolutely.
Get that. You know, if you guys were at the keynote earlier, Amr Paul was speaking a little bit about back in the 90s, a little bit before my time, when we were going towards, you know, the internet and everyone wanted to stay with punch cards. Why do we need to digitize? But you see those companies now that wanted to stay the old way, they're not really there anymore, you know, just like Amr said. So we're definitely need to work together to move towards the future.
There's so much opportunity, so much money to be had, that there's room for multiple companies, multiple industries. I mean, we're partnering with PGE right now on a bi-directional charger pilot, leveraging our Bolt technology. So utilities, I think, understand the role that we all play in it. We understand very much the role that the utility plays, the way that, you know, many of the companies that you represent play in it. And we are looking forward to solving this problem together.
Thank you guys for your input. Did you want to add?
No, I think I agree with you know, both of them here. We do see utilities do play a huge role. Like we've seen it with when solar was a new technology when they brought it up. So I think a lot of partnership, a lot of innovation, you know, especially with, you know, everybody has a role to play. And there's a lot of data that's available as well to support all this stuff. So
yeah, we're all in this together.
Yeah, one last comment. And we are literally about to put terawatt hours of demand onto the already unstable grid. We understand that to, you know, accelerate our core automotive business, we need to make sure that these, you know, challenges are overcome. And we actually believe now our vehicle becomes a, instead of a, you know, call it a detriment to the grid, but become a point of resiliency to the grid. So exciting.
Yeah, exciting stuff. Yeah. All right, next question. What are your customers asking for you in the home of the future? Like, what are some of the dominant requests that are coming through?
Yeah, I guess I'll start with that one. So this is a very interesting one, and I've been talking about this for about 10 years now with different inverter companies. So, you know, the thing about homeowners is they want stuff that's reliable, right? So, you know, for example, a lot of people that have adopted solar, you know, the two biggest complaints I hear are, you know, the internet goes down and now I can't see my system working. And then the other one is, you know what, solar's worked great for 3 months, and now all of a sudden I have a bill, right? And it's because people's habits change when they get these things put on their homes. And just like myself, I had no bill and I started with $50 and then I went to $100 a month. And it's because your habits change. So, you know, giving the consumer tools to control power, because the problem with energy or power is it's invisible, right? And when you get your bill every month, it's like the boogeyman. You don't know what it's gonna be, right? I mean, and if you live in California, in a lot of instances, it's your second highest bill to your mortgage.
Yeah.
So, you know, these are like real concerns. And, you know, I was talking to Simon earlier about this is, you know, there's devices out there that we could learn from, and like the Nest thermostat and the Ecobee, you know, how it learned your habits. And, you know, if we can integrate something like that into the battery and the EV and the solar to where it, you know, it kind of gives the homeowner control, right? And we're not talking control like you go into an app and have to mess with it. You know, something that thinks for you and gives you things, you know, text message says, hey, if you turn on your dishwasher at 6 instead of 5, it's going to cost you half the power, right? And so kind of something like that that's, at the end of the day, has to be reliable. Mm-hmm. And that's what I really think is the end goal in this as far as the smart home and the consumer.
Yeah, giving them the freedom to make their own decisions on
yeah.
what energy they use, when they use their energy, things like that.
Yeah, so also from my side, what we see is we have a lot of subscribers who subscribe to electric vehicles. So an average life cycle of a subscription in our company is about 16 months. So 70% of the subscribers do ask for a charging solutions to be installed in their home. So currently what we're doing is we're partnering up with, like, you know, Schneider and others to provide that service across. We need to have certified people. Also, subscribers are asking, there's a huge cost that is added when it comes to you know, charging solutions where they need to change certain things. So we're also working with them to provide finance solutions to have access to stuff like that as well.
Yeah, that's awesome. I didn't know that they were doing that when I spoke to you. You mentioned that before. Yeah. And that the charging infrastructure anxiety kind of goes into what we were talking about before, some of their biggest concerns. So definitely, you know, trying to increase that infrastructure, keep having chargers in the homes as well as wherever you go, whether it's the grocery store, you know, your child's dance class, things like that.
Yeah, so that change is happening. And secondly, just a couple of other things that I want to add is that not only homes, but also cities are looking to put infrastructure, and they're looking to get more data from our subscribers to see where they're traveling and where they need to be installed as well. So there's a demand on that, and condos and buildings, you know, before you'll see like 2-3 charging infrastructures, now they want a lot more as well. And they also want EV cars as well.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, I think we touched on a lot of the topics. It really comes down to education. The customer still learning about the space, the benefits, the cost benefits, benefits to you know, again, the CO2 and the environmental emissions. But we're coming into a more and more connected society. The way the vehicle within the home, you know, connects within load management, connects within, you know, just centralized we'll call it controls of the way the home is interfaced and interacted with. This is just, again, another huge opportunity for us to, to educate, to provide solutions, from backup resiliency to how loads are distributed in the home. It's an exciting time.
Yeah, really exciting stuff. So I have one more question for you guys here, but before I ask, I forgot to mention in the beginning that we are going to do a Q&A at the end of this. So if you go into your Schneider Events app and scroll down to our event that says Transforming Home Energy Systems for the EV Revolution, it's a little Q&A button. You can click there and input any questions that you have, and we'll try to get to as many as we can at the end. All right, so the last question that I have for you all is, what does the future look like in regards to EV technology? What other technologies do you see coming on the forefront?
Well, I mean, at General Motors, we're at two kind of, again, main generational challenges, how the vehicle is moving, like autonomous technology we're working on with our Cruise division, and now the way that we're going to move energy right through what we're doing with GM Energy. The vehicle will, again, as I alluded to, already is already happening, but it will come more and more part of an Internet of Things. One of the key technologies that we're going to have to continue to work on is, battery cell cost, the chemistry, the reliability of it. I mean, we invest a lot of our R&D dollars to do so. So I think that's one of the key technologies that we're going to have to continue to work through. And then just the overall connectivity between, whether it's the vehicle to home, vehicle to grid, or vehicle to vehicle, these are all parts of how we bring the solution together.
Yeah, I mean, being I've been in this renewable space for 15 years now, a lot of people that I've been around that long, they talk about hydrogen, right? Hydrogen is becoming more and more of a topic, and a lot of people are looking at it. That's one source. And like I said earlier, the answer is multiple sources here, right? And the other thing too is, I liken the battery to like what solar modules were in 2007, 2008. My first solar module I sold was 140 watt module. Today, that same footprint is 550 watts. Mm-hmm. So, these batteries, as technology gets better, we could see them shrink, we could see them charge in a less amount of time. There's just a lot more advances coming, I think, in the technology side, and also probably the chemistry makeup of these things that's going to evolve over time and really make this a really viable option, right? Not that it isn't today, but just evolution makes things better.
Things are always changing over time. We're always trying to improve, so definitely will get better.
Yeah, just want to add a couple of small points to what they mentioned is one of the things that's happening is the shift, right? So, from an asset, it's becoming a utility, right? So, as we go through this technology, more people are using EV as a utility just to go to point A to point B. And a lot of these vehicles are similar, just like your iPhone 13 versus 14. They just the same when it comes to electric vehicles. So I think the more, in terms of tech-wise, what's gonna happen is it's, vehicle to vehicle, there's a lot of more data that's available to understand some of the major challenges where how to scale this up in terms of charging, reducing the time it requires for charging, and a lot of infrastructure that is universal as well. So I think some of those areas.
Yeah, definitely.
That's one of the point. We talk a lot about innovation and technology, but the innovation of business models is going to disrupt the way ownership of a vehicle turns out, whether it's subscription models, whether it's shared car park. When we get to an autonomous fleet, it may very well change the way we own these products, and I think we need to be at open-minded to how that evolves. So lots of opportunity again for business and it's exciting future.
Yeah. Thank you, guys. Yeah. Did you want to add
anything? No, I said that's a good point.
Good point, yeah. Thank you guys for all of your wonderful insight. Yeah, it's truly appreciated. So we do have a quick surprise for you guys. We're gonna show a really quick video. I'm gonna signal to my people back there to turn the video on. And it's about the new GM and energy organization that just was announced yesterday, William. Yeah, and then William, you can share a little bit more about that after the video.
The times, they are a-changin'. Good mothers and fathers throughout all the land. And don't criticize what you can't understand. Your sons and your daughters are beyond your command. Your
Sorry, I can't help but to get excited about it. So, yeah, a little note, I was at that commercial shoot, and it looks a lot different when it comes together.
Do you want to share a little bit more?
Yeah, so on Tuesday, we announced the new GM Energy business unit. So we're going to be offering a full set of products to couple with our, complement our EV fleet. So everything from stationary storage, bi-directional charging, and partnering with our exclusive solar partner, SunPower here. We're going to, again, bring in that holistic energy solution to the home. And then we also have launched now our GM Energy commercial business units, where we'll be bringing a full suite of commercial industrial products, including a 1 megawatt, 2 megawatt hour stationary storage system. Again, when you couple that with bi-directional charging, solar and renewable generation, it's an opportunity for us to help solve some of those problems you saw in the video. So very excited, and very excited to talk more about that with all of you.
Yeah, really building homes of the future together is what we're doing. Yeah. All right, so I'm gonna pass it over to the Q&A, if you wanna go ahead.
Hello, we have a couple questions. First question is for you, William. Now that GM is in the EV space in full force, is there an opportunity to reopen the hydrogen-powered vehicle?
Yes. I can't steal too much thunder, but yes. We so some of my teams here, and we've worked on hydrogen vehicles in the past. General Motors has spent a significant amount of R&D dollars into hydrogen technology over the last decades, and it's definitely something that we're very interested in. As we now, again, go deeper into the energy sector, hydrogen is a long, I'll call it long-duration energy and storage, asset in itself, is a huge role in that potential business unit. So I can't announce anything. I don't want Mary to get mad at me, but hydrogen is part of our future.
Awesome. Thank you. We do have another question. Does bi-directional charging shorten the life of EV's battery through increased cycling?
That's a great question.
Great question. No. So we are very much understanding the cycling that comes along with, discharging and charging to back up your home. We will make sure utmost quality and safety is put into our vehicles to make sure that, the main functionality that the customer buys for, to have that reliability and durability for getting from A to B, is still there. But we will absolutely make sure that that doesn't cause degradation to the main functionality. So it's something that's a great question. It's something that we're going to have to educate customers on, but we think we have that managed.
All right, we do have one more question that just came into the queue. When will the GM Energy products be available for customers?
I can't tell you yet, no. But no, so we did announce that the bi-directional charging and the home energy ecosystem will be available with the launch of the Silverado retail vehicle, which is planned for next fall.
Awesome. Well, thanks, guys.
Thank you. If there's any more questions, if you want to raise your hand, if you thought of anything.
If anyone does have any interest about what we're doing with GM Energy, please go to GM Energy, gm.gmenergy.com. There's a whole slew of additional details. I'm willing to connect with anyone in the room who has interest in. We're super excited to be here, and we want to thank Schneider for hosting all of us. It's and my fellow panelists, it's a huge opportunity for us to connect with like-minded people in the space.
Thank you. Do you guys have anything you wanted to say? Some last words?
No, I just want to thank, like Will said, thanks Schneider for giving us this platform to speak on this. And, from Gray Bar's point of view, really appreciate the long history partnership that we have with Schneider.
Yeah. Same thing. I just want to thank everyone as well, and for everyone to attend one of the last sessions. So from our side, from Steer EV, check out our website to understand a little bit more about EVs and how you can have access to electric vehicles. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you all. And we did finish up a little bit early, so I'm going to tell you guys, if you are interested in learning more about Homes of the Future, you can actually head over to the Innovation Hub, and all the way at the back, we have our Home of the Future booth, where you can see our new Schneider Charge EV charger that's there, and talk with some of the staff about it if you're interested. So thank you all so much for joining. Thank you for coming to the Innovation Summit, and I hope you guys get home safe and have a great rest of your day.